Zachary had spoke to me. She said, why don't you do the chase? And as I was thinking of what I was going to do and how I was going to present it, a lot of things kind of flowed through my mind and how it all kind of comes together as one. One scripture that I really want to share with you all is a scripture how not to be anxious. Mm. Don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. That is Philippians 4, 6, 7. Every morning when I wake up, I go through a process, and that process is to meditate. Now, all of us have that opportunity and know the real way of how to do it. And when you meditate and bring yourself together, you kind of open up your eyes and minds to a lot of things. So I want to talk about, there's one thing in your life that you would like to share, and it's the right thing is to share your testimony and how you have to have that courage and that being to do so. And, you know, God speaks to us in so many different ways. That He can speak to you while you're in the car. He can speak to you while you're brushing your teeth, while you're in the shower. But sometimes we have to understand when He's actually talking to you. Because it could just be your mind racing with different thoughts, but it's not actually the Lord talking to you. It's your mind going in different directions, and your mind's not sure what step it needs to take. And so over the years, I have indirectly received the notice of telling people where I've come from and where I am today. Now, the time does not allow for me to share it at all, but I wanted to share the most two important things that has happened in my life where it caused me to chase a lot of things in my life that did not bring me quite joy. So first I want to say that here at the Redeemer's House, I am so excited and welcome for the ladies to welcome me into the Women of Excellence. You know, our theme is calm down, don't panic, and be prepared. And as every day as I read those words, they make more sense as you pull them together. You know, the first time I read the words, it was like, okay, calm down, don't panic. Okay, yeah, okay, that's easy. You know, then as you live your life, you begin to think it's really not as easy as you think. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not easy to calm down in a time of worry and, you know, calm down when you're feeling your thoughts are not right and then being prepared for what God is going to bestow upon you in your life. And so the Redeemer's House here, what we're doing is we're helping women. Our theme is move from grace into influence, and we're helping women to become an influence to others. And that's ultimately my goal, basically, in life, is to become a woman of influence and influence others. It could be women, it could be children, it could be men, it could be anybody, but just being an influence of somebody where something that I have said has helped you move in a better direction. So what I wanted to do, I created these little cards, and I want you to take these cards with you, and anytime that you feel that you need to calm down and don't panic and be prepared, you know, read this, because what it does is it helps you. It gives you, takes you to a whole other level. So you see where it says, calm down when I feel worried. Don't panic when things get rough. Be prepared to receive the blessings God will bestow upon me. I am a woman of excellence, learning to become a woman of influence. You know, we have to learn to become a woman of influence. We have to stop doing certain things in our lives so we're able to influence others in a positive way. And sometimes, you know, our tongues get in the way of making us go in the right direction. You know, we say some things and, you know, we'll cut people real off real quick and then we'll keep walking, but our head's still saying hi and that person's sitting there all belittled and you don't care. But your tongue hurts and you have to really understand how we process that and how to talk to people. So each of you here are a woman of excellence, and each of you will become a woman of influence through a lot of change that you do in your life and how things happen. You know, when we take real concrete steps, just real concrete steps, and beginning to see, we start to see things very differently. We have to take a moment and say, you know what, I just can't do that right now. You know, we have to really concentrate on that and really focus on how to handle that, because it's not easy to do that. This one author says, her name was Kishtan Wisdom, and she says, stop chasing what your mind wants, but give what your soul needs. Just think about that. Stop chasing what your mind wants, but give what your soul needs. If we would change our thinking, we'll ultimately be winners within ourselves. And as we grow in life, what I have realized is that I've chased a lot of things that have not brought me joy. It could be the chase of being protected, the chase of people and their approval, the chase of money and success, the chase of your dreams. That's a lot of things that we go through as women. We tend to chase a lot of different things. And before I get started, I want to just really express that as you think about the things that you chase in your life, you really have to wonder, like, was it really worth it? Was it worth me going through all this trouble and time to just get to where I'm going? So I'm going to list a couple of things out about chasing different things in our lives that we're chasing. Just kind of raise your hand if you have experienced it or are experiencing it now. You don't have to say, well, this is where I'm going through now, but just raise your hand if you experienced it. And I'm going to give definitions to it, because I have to really give you Linnea's explanation on how it works, okay? Chasing security. The definition of security is the state of being protected and safe from harm. So in our minds, security means, you know, when you got your Comcast or whatever, and when you put in your numbers and you got your little phone and you can see every little thing that's going on in your house, that's security, right? But when I'm talking about chasing security is that, for example, you're living with someone that you don't love, but you are only there because they're giving you a secure place to live. It's a security that you know that he's always going to be there if you just do those things for him, or he's always going to provide for me if I say this and the way he wants it. He's always going to protect me. That's that chasing security. And then think about chasing jobs, taking a job that's beneath me. Now understand, I have been there. I have taken plenty of jobs that was way under my qualifications because I needed a paycheck. But you also have to think about it. When you get to a point where when you take that job just so you can have that security of that steady check, and when you complain about it every day, when every day there is something about that job that bugs you, that just hits you in a way, that means you're chasing the security of just having a job. All you're there is that you're getting up, you're basically wasting your time. You're getting up every morning, you're washing your face, you're driving these hours and these minutes, you know, Atlanta traffic, trying to get to this location, and knowing that in your body and your soul it's just not right, you know, and it's just a check. And then what goes in compass to that is chasing money. We've chased money. You know, you chase that money And it's a vicious circle, and you're going to hear me talk about this circle. The circle, and I'm not talking about the circle of friends, I'm just talking about the circle of life. Because when we go in a circle, we just keep going around and around and around. We never go left and we never go right. We just keep going around and around, and we're chasing money and chasing things that we think that's going to make us happy. Then you're chasing your work. And I know I was talking about having that security for your job, but think about your job where you give 100% to that job. Your whole entire soul is to that job. You get up in the morning and the first thing you do instead of pray is you look at your email to see who sent you something last night. Or the first time that you walk in the door, you wake up and you get at the job at 6:30 in the morning just so you can have some quiet peace in your office before you get started. You're chasing work because you shouldn't have to feel that way. You shouldn't have to have that feeling that when you get up and you have to, I gotta do this, I have to do this. And what that does is it reduces time with your family, and it takes time away from yourself when all you're doing is just work and work and work and not giving anything to yourself. Now this one is really a big one for me, and that is chasing the approval and acceptance of others. We as women, we do that. We do it, and we may not do it openly, but we do it in some type of way. And I'm going to say here, there may be some of you that saw something that someone has on today, and your man said something in the back of your mind, and all she wanted to do was dress nice, and it's all she wanted to do. But we're always chasing for the approval of someone. We're always chasing for that acceptance from someone and what they want and what they say and how they feel about you. And then let's talk about material things. It's beautiful. It's nice to have that big house. It's great to have that great car. It's nice to have them purses. It's nice to have them shoes. I was looking at some shoes today. And I had to ask Jesus, please save me from these shoes. But it's those material things. You think about the material things, which all we think about is, I gotta work, I gotta grind, I gotta get, because my house gotta be big, I gotta have this, and I gotta have this car, I gotta have this, I gotta do this. But what happens if God just takes it all away? What happens when he just one day, everything's just gone? What you gonna chase then? Then chasing love. This is a really special one for me. Forcing someone to love you because you know that you can change them into the person that you want them to be. We would live our lives and die trying to convince somebody to love us the way we want them to be, opposed from having the right person come to us and love us the right way. We can't continue to just sit and think that, okay, you know, if I just do this a little differently, they'll love me a little bit more. If I stroke his back a little bit more, if I make him some food, if I do this, if I make sure I wash his clothes a different way, if I do this, if I talk to him a different way, I'll do this. And you're chasing him. And then all you're doing is really chasing the idea of love. And then chasing people. And it goes into a connection with chasing approval and acceptance of people. But just chasing people alone. Think about it. You have an acquaintance that you like. You like to talk to them every so often, but you're trying to figure out why they're not talking to you and why they're not communicating with you. And you wonder, you say, man, why am I chasing this person and trying to figure out what's going on? In reality, it's really them that is the problem, and you have to allow them to work it out. And so we find ourselves just chasing people back and forth and over again. So that's chasing security, chasing money, chasing work, chasing acceptance, chasing material things, chasing love, and chasing people. Those are all the things as women, what we do, and those are things that we have to really work on. There are certain people that come into our lives, and we have to understand the right people that come into our lives. There are wrong people that come into our lives, and there are right people that come into our lives. And we have to determine who we need to cut out of our circle in order to live a better life. You know, recently, I want to share this because recently I had a long-time friend. I say had, a very long-time friend. And we've been friends for, you know, a good 35, 36 years. And what I noticed about this friend is that every time that I would talk with her, everything was 100% negative. It was as if I was on the phone, I could feel the negative energy come through the phone into my body, literally. And it would take me good 30, 40 minutes to just degress from that conversation. My husband would say to me, he said, okay, I'm gonna give you a minute to process everything you just heard, because I was sitting on the phone and I wouldn't say a word. It would be a good 30, 40 minutes and not one word would come out my mouth. And everything they would say was just the negativity. And then I would ask myself, I said, why am I listening to this? And all I was thinking about was, because she's my friend, and I don't want to lose her as a friend, but I'm like, well, maybe she's really not like the best of friends. You know, she's probably not the right person I need to talk to or to have in my aura. And I think I realized that as I grow, as you grow into a person, as a different person, you realize that there's some people you need to just totally cut out your life. And sometimes it hurts. You know, she and I have been friends since eighth grade. And I had to cut her off my life. So what I did, the fashionable me, I sent her a nice little email. Because I couldn't, because if I would have called her and put it on a voicemail message, I would have got angry. I would have just started talking and all kinds of things would have came out my mouth. I know me. Because I have to sit and write things out. That's just me, I have to write it out. So I sent her a nice email and I wished her the best, and I said that I don't understand why this time that you chose not to communicate with me, but now it seems starting to affect me a little bit more than I wanted. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna kind of release this. And whenever you have time, you're more than welcome to reach out to me, but understand this will be my last communication to you. That's been 60 days, haven't heard a word, which is fine. I'm okay with that. So when God places the right people in your life, you really remember them. And the one person that I remember is my grandmother. I call her the MVP of grandmothers. She was saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost, if y'all have ever heard that before. Okay. Everything was to perfection for her, but she was a loving grandmother. She taught me how to read the Bible. She taught me how to pray. She taught me how to change things in my life. And when she died in 87, a piece of me went with her, because as I was still young, I really still needed her in my life to help me guide me into a young adult. And I understand that we all are gonna die someday, but I wasn't ready for her to go. So it took a little piece of me. Okay, so what I'm about to share with you all, I want to kind of tell you something. I want to share with something with you all. And what I'm about to share with you all, it's really not for you all to feel sorry for me, or feel any kind of way, but what I want to do is give you an example of two main things that I struggled with in my life. And I chased everything from love, material things, money, acceptance, approval for others, security, and work. But the most difficult for me to overcome was the acceptance of approval, the acceptance and approval of people, and the acceptance of love. And that came early, okay? And then, you know, some of you out here that know me over 10 years, and some of you may have heard this before, and some of you may not. But it was a struggle for me, and I think over the last 15 years, it really, really opened up my eyes. And I think because as I repaired one relationship, I helped another relationship blossom in the process of this. So let me just kind of give you a little feedback. I grew up on the west side of Chicago. My mother is 18 years older than I am. And so basically, when she was growing up, I was growing up. That's basically how it worked. All I kind of know or remember about my father is that he was a married CTA bus driver. I only saw him one time when he came to my house because everybody in the neighborhood thought my mother had gotten pregnant by the guy down the street. So he had to come to the house so she can prove to everybody that I was his child. So all I remember about him is that he had freckles like I had on my hand. He had freckles on his hands and on his face. And I never saw him again. When I was in high school, my mother actually would come and tell me, she told me, this is his name. This is where he lived. This is where I remembered where he lived. And you can go find him if you want to. That was her response. So I did that. But when I started looking for him, he had died a year earlier. And his wife and kids didn't want anything to do with him. His wife knew about him, but she didn't want to have anything to do with him. It's okay. So as I grew up fabricating different stories of a happy life. But my life really wasn't all that happy. My mother and I had a very strained relationship. Extremely strained. And I always call her the person that gave birth to me. She really wasn't like a mother. And I a lot of years as I grow and as I'm a mother, I can make sure that I always look and make sure I don't do the same things that she did so I can prove to myself that I can be a better mother. So I want to tell you why she really wasn't the best mother, because as a child, she didn't protect me. As my mother, she didn't protect me as a child, and it took me a long time to really forgive her and to get over those situations. When I was 6 years old, and I'm taking y'all back, okay, so y'all can really understand the process. When I was 6 years old, my mother married this man he had blue eyes and blonde hair. And he was my sister's father. And everything that I did around the house, he would have an issue with. It was just me. He would have an issue with. So as a seven-year-old, I would do a lot of things. Not these seven-year-olds in 2017 where, you know, everything is all electronics. When I was 7 years old, I was washing baseboards. I was mopping floors. I was cleaning toilets. I was cooking. I was cleaning. I was doing everything at 7 years old, and I was always taught like that, and that's how I teach my children. But you have to understand that at seven, I was doing extremely a lot because again, my mother was just that body in the house. So one day I got in trouble about something. I can't remember what it was. I'm 7 years old. I'm a girl. I'm busy. I can't tell you what it was. It was something I did. And so my mother told me I couldn't go outside. So if I couldn't go outside, that means my sister couldn't go outside because I was to watch her. And so one day my mother, she ran to the store and she says, okay, Lene, I want you to cook the rice while I run to the store. So as soon as she walked out the door, I go into the pantry, I get the rice. And as soon as I turn around, he's standing right there. And as he's standing there, you can just kind of see the tint in his eyes. And the next thing I know, he pushes me against the wall and he's holding me by my neck up off the floor at 7 years old. And he says to me, he says, see, I told you, you little nigga, I told you that I'm going to get you because my baby couldn't go outside. All I remember in this whole process is waking up on my bed. my mother's on this side, and he's on this side of me, holding my arm real tight. And my mom says, well, Ernie found you on the floor. And he said, you know, you just came in there and he found you on the floor. And before I could say, Mommy, that's not what happened, he squeezed my arm so tight under cover, I just said, I don't know what happened. I couldn't tell. So a few months had went by, and I had an opportunity to, you know, to sit with her. You know, we were sitting in the living room, I sit with her. And I really wanted to tell her what happened. I really wanted to tell her exactly what happened. So I began to tell her the story. I began to tell her how verbally and physically abusive he was. I began to tell her how the day that I fainted in the pantry, and how it was him that choked me and had me faint. And as I'm telling the story, she's just looking at me, just a stone look, no expression, nothing. She's just looking at me. And a minute just kind of went by, and she says to me, she says, that's some story you came up with. I see now. I believe what he says when he says you were trying to break us up. You fabricating these stories. I should whoop you for coming up with this story. Go to your room. So at that point, at 7 years old, I was basically on my own. Because I couldn't share with her exactly how I was feeling, what was going on. A year later, he left and moved to California. And when he left, his physical abuse left, but her physical and verbal abuse started. So it was my fault that he left. Every time she brought him up, it was my fault that he left. On my birthday, the day of my 9th birthday, she wakes me up and she shakes me. And I'm noticing that everything in my room, all my pictures are taken down in my room. And I'm noticing there's like 2 bags sitting there next to the floor. And she tells me, she says, I want you to get in the car. So we get in the car. And she drives me to my grandmother's house. And she tells me, get out the car. I get out the car. She puts my bags on the curb. She drives off. For 2 years, I did not see or hear from my mother. My grandmother would explain to me that your mother is going through something right now. Your mother needs to process different things right now. So you really, I need you to pray for her. And I was would talk to my grandmother, and I said, and one day I was joking, I said, Granny, am I adopted? I had to ask that question. I said, because there's no way that my grandmother, with the nice, beautiful soul that she had, how loving she was, could actually birth this woman. I said, am I adopted? And my grandmother, she was sitting, she said, no, baby. And then she came out, she said, you're not adopted, but your mother is. And then it dawned on me, I said, oh my goodness, okay. So you are not of the same gene as she is. So this answers all the questions. This tells me a whole lot. When I was 11 years old, my mom just all of a sudden shows up, and she shows up at the door, and she says, I'm coming to get Linnea. And my grandmother said, where you taking her? Well, she's going to move to California with us, because I need her to watch the baby. So at 11 years old, I was heading to O'Hare Airport, moving to Culver City, California, to watch my six-year-old sister at 11. 6 months later, we ended up moving back to Hinsdale, Illinois. Now, I understand my mother wanted to make sure that she was far away from my mother. It was very key that she did not live anywhere near my grandmother. Okay, so my grandmother lived on the west side of Chicago. We lived in the west suburbs. My mother lived in Hinsdale. And at that time, she met this man named Mr. Myers. Now, Mr. Myers was a different type of guy. Okay, he was an older gentleman. This time, he still had blue eyes, but his hair was brown. And this man, when I say that he was rich, he was rich. He had everything. And so the thing about my mother is that nothing is, she spares no cost to anything. Everything has to be A-okay, 100% sharp, gotta be beautiful. And he gave that to her. Gave her cars, jewelry, clothes, everything. And so anytime that my sister and I would ask for things, we wouldn't get them. But my grandmother would buy us some things, but my grandmother wouldn't let us take those things with us because we needed clothes at the house to go to church in. Because, you know, Granny wasn't playing that. Granny wanted to make sure that you were 100% clean when you walked in the door. So you had to have your tights, your shoes, your hair bows. Everything had to be right. You know, because she, you know, she was the head of the mother's board, and the mother's board head wasn't going to have play that. You got to understand. My granny wasn't going to have that. And so my mother, Mr. Myers was kind of nice. You know, he was okay guy. You know, he was okay. Until the day that he came into my room and molested me. So at the age of 12, I lost my virginity to a 58-year-old man. So I would tell, my grandmother would know, and I wouldn't say anything to anybody because I thought it was going to be a whole repeat of the whole Ernie situation with the husband, and I just didn't say anything to anyone. But my grandmother knew. She knew, and she would go to my mother and she would say, I need you to do something about that man because he's touching them girls. And my mother would just kind of shrug it off. But as soon as we got back to the house, my mother would whoop both of us and say, stop going off and telling my business. Stop telling people what's going on in my house. So I really couldn't express what was going on. But then my grandmother came to me and one day and she sat me down and she said, look, you're 12 years old. She said, you're very strong. She said, I need you to start taking care of yourself. I need you to figure out what you can do. She said, God is not telling me to hurt the man, but I'm just telling you, you need to protect yourself and you need to protect your sister. So throughout the year, I began to protect me and my sister. So our bedroom was up these stairs. It was like these attic bedrooms. So my bedroom was up the stairway. And so I would put things in front of the stairs to keep him from getting into our room. So anytime that he would step on something, it would kind of scare him off, and then he would change his mind and not come up there. And then when I was 14, he got upstairs. He finally made it up the stairs, and when he made it to my bed, I just started kicking and screaming and hollering and punching. And did everything my grandmother told me to, and I even had a knife ready to do whatever I had to do to make sure he did not touch me. That day, that was the last time that he laid hands on me. And I made sure that I wanted to protect my sister always. I really wanted to give her that opportunity to protect her, to be with her. So that's kind of how my relationship with my mother has always been. And it never really changed until about, I would say about 10 years ago. She came and visited us down here in Georgia, and anytime my mother would come visit, it used to be like this, but every time she would come visit, I would get really anxious because I felt that I had to prove something to her. I felt that whatever, I had to make sure that everything was perfect because I didn't want her to see anything different. I wanted her to realize that I was raising my children so differently from how she raised me. But I wanted her to see that I had everything all together. It was part of her process, but it was a vicious circle process. And so when she came to visit me one day, we were sitting on the porch and she was really quiet. And she just came out and she said to me, she says, I just want to apologize. I want to apologize for not being that mother. And understand that I really had that anger. I was really mad at her. I was upset with her. But I had to realize that it really wasn't her fault. And many of you may think it was her fault, but it wasn't her fault. It was her fault of those men that did that to me. It was their actions. All that she could not handle is that she couldn't get over her own self-gratification of being just her. So she had to find her process with God and get that relationship, her own relationship. She had to repair that before she could come to me. And when she came to me and she told me that the way you interact with your kids is just remarkable. She said, I could never, never imagine me ever doing that for you and your sister. How you interact, how you talk to them, how patient you are. I remember one of my twins, they did something, and back in her day, in her house, if I would have done that, I would have just got a spanking out of this world. But in turn, I just had a talk with her, and I told her, I tell my kids, I explain to them, now, I can get down with it real quick, but I'm going to talk to you first. And if my talking don't work, then I'm going to go to different measures. And they know that, and they understand that. And see, that's how I wanted to raise my children, so they could understand and get an idea of what was going on. So, although she kind of failed to protect me as a child, when she started to apologize, I felt the forgiveness coming over me. Because I understood that she now understood and saw exactly what happened and what she was doing and what the consequences were and what happened. And I forgive her for that. And my process was, I always chased for the approval of her. I went to school and graduated with the degree that she wanted me to graduate with. I always wanted to either one, become a lawyer or become a counselor since I was little, because I wanted to be able to help kids. I didn't want kids to go through what I went through. But she insisted that I graduate in marketing. So I took a path of working in marketing. I worked in marketing for 20 years. I hated it. It just drove me crazy. I didn't like it. Although I was making oohs and ahs of money, I hated it. It was not me. It did not complete me. So I continued to chase and chase and chase for her approval, for her to accept everything that I did. And then it came to me. I used to always talk about how I wanted to not be like her. And then my husband was sitting, he would constantly remind me, he said, look, you need to calm down. And if anybody know my husband, you know what he actually said. But you need to calm down. Your soul and your spirit is not like that. Understand, calm down. When you get so consumed with the thought of proving yourself to somebody, it affects everything you do. Don't chase the thought of making sure that someone else is happy and you're ruining your own happiness. It doesn't help. Stop worrying about different things that people are not accepting of you, or people don't want to talk to you in a certain way. Maybe because they don't want to receive that. So what I want to do is, I want to take an opportunity before I tell you the next part. I want to kind of take an opportunity to just kind of talk about different things that we kind of chase in our life. So raise your hand if you've ever chased love. If you ever chased approval and acceptance, if you ever chased security, if you ever chased money. Chase work. So think about that. And you think about those things that you kind of chase in your life, and you're wondering, like, is it really bringing you joy? Is there like an end result to it? So you're constantly chasing these things. Some of y'all raise my hand about chasing money. If we stop thinking about the dollar, okay? Because it's hard now, right? It's hard to not think about that money. You know, because, you know, I would love a whole lot of it. Believe me, I would. And if we stop thinking about that money and really process of how we can really channel it, I want to say this because I used to chase money a whole lot. It used to be an ongoing thing for me. I needed, like, every time I needed a dollar. I couldn't fathom the fact of just not having nothing. So when, and this is a whole different story, I'm not going to go into this, but in one part of my life, God had took things away from me, out of my life. And he didn't do it not one time, he did it twice. Now the first time he did it, I would say a soft sell. Okay, that's what I call it. Okay, because the first time he did it, he only did it a little bit, and I didn't listen that first time. Okay, and then the second time he did it like, you know, as my husband called, my husband said, we came out of Egypt. That's what he said. Because he, you know, he always referred to it out of Egypt. You know, we coming out of Egypt. And when he took it, when that second time he took it, he took everything. I mean, when I say everything, he took everything. Okay? And that is when I had to really think. And we began to really think about it. So you have to think about when you're chasing that money and chasing your dreams, you have to really sit and think about how you're going to handle those different things. Chasing luck. Yes, ma'am.
Could you define the word chase?
Sure. Chase, in my own words, chase is something that you continue to go after over and over again. Okay? There's no actual end point to it. You're continually running, and going for it over and over again. And if you see yourself kind of going through those processes, that's when you have to kind of make a determination. So my sister Clavia, we talk every so often, and we always talk about talking about chasing our businesses and chasing the things that we want to do. But we have really good concrete conversations about making sure that we're not chasing the wrong thing and the wrong people. In that process, because everybody don't need it, okay? But something that you do, Kat, someone may need it. Something that Angie, you do, something you do, they may need it. You know, something that you do, Shonda, they may need it. But we always have to go out there and get it, but not worry about the chase of it all and say, okay, all right, so I went to my friend yesterday and I said this to her, okay, she gonna be the one gonna take my business to the top. And you sitting there, you waiting. And you waiting. And you waiting. You know, and then you have to really say, okay, you know what, no, that's not gonna happen. You know, chasing love. Who's all chased love before? Okay. So let me talk about chasing love. So y'all go through this process, you're chasing your love, and you want to make sure everything's okay, so you're on the phone, you're checking text messages, you go on his Facebook page, you send him a text message, you like, why he ain't calling me back? Oh, you still trying to look, you looking, because you're in love now, right? You know, it's because you done opened it up, you done gave him everything, all the cookies and goodies and everything else, and so you want to try to figure out why he ain't calling you back, and you just chasing the idea of love. You know, he said, I hit you back in a few minutes and you didn't ever hear from him. And then you're going in this circle again. You're in this whole vicious circle. And you're like, okay, why didn't he call me? Man, I laid it on him, but he ain't called me back yet. Then you're wondering what's going on. You know what's going on because you gave him everything that he wanted. And so now he don't need nothing from you. Why would he talk to you now? You know, why would he have a conversation with you now? You have to make friends. Let him become a friend. Be your friend. Talk to him. Have good conversation. You know, one of the other major issues that I struggled with was the whole chasing of love. And a couple months ago, we had a mic night, and I kind of told the story of how I met my husband. But I want to kind of get before that. Before I met my husband, I was dating this guy. He's very controlling, and I really understand that I was still going through that process of really understanding men, because only men that really been in my life have been the men that actually harmed me. So I really couldn't understand, getting a grasp of really what a man was supposed to do and really understand love. And one day I came home for spring break from college, it was 2 weeks before spring break from college. And as I pulled up in front of his house, he was coming out the door with another woman. And as he was coming down the stairway with another woman, he saw me in the car, and he and I locked eyes. I mean, when I say, I mean, the eyes just locked. And then all you saw was him running to the car with her to get her in the car, and I'm speeding up down the street. Now, if anybody never been to Chicago, in Chicago, you know, you got the, you got one-way, you got two-way streets, so we're going down the two-way street, but the street's only this big. You're going down the two-way street, and then we're going down alleyways, we jumping. I'm chasing them. Now, I'm chasing them down the alley hood, because I'm from West Side of Chicago, so I was about to go down, okay? So we're chasing down the alleys and everything, and then one, all of a sudden, I just heard stop. Just stop, just come over my whole mind. And then a few seconds later, this big semi-truck just passed by. Now, I wouldn't be sitting here right here today if I had just kept going. But something in my mind told me to stop. But you would think that something in my mind would tell me to take my tail home. But did I go home? No. No, I didn't go home. Because what I was doing, I was, what, chasing love, right? So, no, I didn't go home. So I decided I'm going to go to his house and wait for him on the porch. You know, because I was hood like that, right? I was going to wait for him. I'm going to wait for him to show up. But he showed up, and when he showed up, he jumped me, pushed me down the stairs, kicked me, told me it was my fault. It was my fault that I saw him with another woman. It was my fault that I was chasing him down the street. It was my fault. So as I was getting back into my car, all upset and crying, thinking I should have took my tail home, I realized that's not what I wanted. I didn't need that relationship.